Hello and welcome to Beauty Espace TV. I'm Ritoo Jhha and I edit the entire bunch of online products that we have with Beauty Espace Media. We are honored to have with us today Pierre Rennette. He is the managing partner and co-owner of Olivia Garden, a 50-plus-year-old brand that has been creating tools for the hairdressing industry, hairbrushes, shears, hair dryers, and so on. It's a huge repertoire. And of course, we have with us Shubham Virmani. He is the distributor here of not only Olivia Garden, but Rica, one of the leading brands across salons in India. Olivia Garden, of course, he has been, kind of been on the top of his game because Olivia Garden is big in education and they have really combined forces very well to, kind of take up that route, which is so relevant for this country. So welcome aboard both Pierre and Shubham. Nice
to
have you.
Thank you so much, Ritoo. Thank you so much for your kind words, Ritoo. And it's a pleasure to be here in this forum.
Yes, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to join you as well today. Thank you for a kind introduction.
Thank you, Pierre. So Pierre, I will quickly, read off, what Olivia Garden is all about. Olivia Garden was created in 67. So you're 50 plus years in the industry, partnering with hairdressers across 100 countries. So nothing is less than 50 as far as you are concerned. 50 plus patents with the products that you have. And you yourself started in 1994. And that's when I believe there was something called Silence HP. This was this curls. You have the Jet Set and Night Curl, a patented product that was launched. And before that, you have the Silent Blow Dryer in 79. You're big on patents. And of course, the eco-friendly bamboo brush way back in 2006. Because we are talking about a lot of bamboo in products now that, eco and sustainability is such a big thing. We understand that without it, we cannot move forward, as an industry, as in fact, the whole earth, we are suffering what we are suffering today. Half of the reason is that we've been so casual about, how we've, lived our lives. So, Pierre, I will start with you. My first question to you would be, 50 years is a lot of time, and yes. We would love to hear from you. What have been your major milestones? What have been the watersheds for your company over the years?
Yes, so thank you very much. So the company was originally started in 1967. So I myself will reach the 50-year milestone next year. So I'm not quite there yet. but it was started in 1967 by my parents, Jean and Micheline Rennette. And my mother was a hairstylist, and my father was a school teacher. Yeah. And my mother convinced my father to join the beauty industry. And my father was an entrepreneur at heart. And so they perceived very early on that there was a need for wigs. Wigs were a beginning of a trend at the time. And, hair products at the time were quite dangerous. Getting your hair color or getting a perm was a chemical experiment. And so people were actually using wigs to style the hair and to color the hair. And a woman would regularly go to the salon to have a wig put in. And so my parents started a wig manufacturing business in 1967. And this is what really led them to introduce the brand Olivia Garden in the industry. They started in the country of Belgium, a country about 9 million, so quite a small market. And they quickly gained a national distribution, both in department stores and also in beauty salons. And as you will see throughout our history, 50 years is a long time. And the one thing about our industry is that it reinvents itself on a regular basis. And so as a company, we have had to reinvent ourselves. If we were still selling wigs today, we would have been out of business. So though the wigs were a very strong product, actually, very quickly, the trends change, and hairspray came along, and women could then style the hair very differently at home and also in the salons. And so instead of getting the hair colored, having a wig colored and having it put on, they actually started getting their hair styled in the salon. And as well, Clairol came out with liquid color at the time, which became a much safer way to color women's hair. And so my parents quickly saw the change in the market. And within 2 years, the wig business had disappeared. And we became actually the first Clairol distributor in Europe. And we imported Clairol into, at the time was owned by Bristol Myers, into Belgium. At the time, Europe was very fragmented. So we were limiting the market, crossing a border, even though there's four countries you could travel to within 20 minutes from our headquarters in Belgium. Really, export didn't really take place much. So it was a very localized market. And then over time, we decided to try to grow the business internationally. And in Europe, L'Oreal and Wella had a very strong grip on the market. And so we decided to focus more on accessories, which gave us an ability to transcend borders. And so we came up with two products. One of them, as you mentioned earlier, was the Silent HP hairdryer. And the other one we caught on early that there was a new trend, which was perming. And so from the 70s, we went from hairspray and styling products to the 80s, we transitioned into a perming business. And every woman was getting perm. And so we actually developed several lines of hair curlers and hair rollers that were patented, didn't use any rubber bands. And that became our leading product range. And again, we had to reinvent ourselves very quickly, but we used that opportunity of change to grow internationally. And for the first time with our hair curlers, we actually grew outside of Belgium into Europe and then into Asia, where there was a lot of demand for hair curlers, especially Japan and even China and Hong Kong at the time, Taiwan. And then from there, the 80s came along, and then suddenly perm business disappeared, and suddenly hairbrushes were the way to style hair. And so we again quickly reinvented ourselves and tried to bring to the hair salon the tools that stylists were actually looking for, because at the time there are very few hairbrushes on the market, just a few paddles. Brushes had been around for 50 years. There was very little innovation in that field. So in the mid to late 90s, the company reinvented itself again, and we developed a wide range of hairbrushes, and then we expanded into shears, and then lately as well, electricals, as well as some other innovative tools.
In fact, in 2012, you have even launched a hairbrush brush guide app.
That's correct.
How could you visualize in 2012? People are still, getting there in 2020s.
Yes. So we were, I think, one of the first beauty companies to launch an app. And, we're avid iPhone and Mac product users. And we saw quickly the opportunity. As you said, one of the biggest questions that we often get from customers and our sales team gets as well is, which brush to use for which kind of hair. And really, we have tens of thousands of stores around the world in different cultures. And so getting across to the consumer and especially to the store employees, how to recommend a product is very challenging. So we came up with the idea of a doctor's prescription pad, where the customer puts in what kind of hair they have. And so they have different criteria, and then the result they want to achieve, and out comes from the app the type of brush recommendation.
Fantastic. And we have your, again, in 2018, the eco-friendly handcrafted bamboo brushes.
Yes, so we were the first company to develop bamboo brushes in the early 2000s, which was quite an innovative product line. And we reinvented it again recently to be even more eco-friendly. We used a process to make a bamboo, which is very eco-friendly because the advantage of bamboo, as you most of your listeners probably know already, is that the plant never dies. So it's basically a root, and the offshoot, it just grows what is visible. And so it has a very low carbon footprint. And so we cut it, it can be cut every 4 months, and it can grow back. Sometimes some species can grow back to 12 feet, so almost 4 meters within just 6 months to 1 year. Unlike a tree, which needs to be cut down and may take decades to grow back.
Sure. So here we also want to understand, amongst all these products, you have your ceramic iron thermal brushes, and you have the hair dryers as well. We really want to understand a little bit about patents, because lots of brands talk about patents across the world, and some take it very seriously, the point why and at what point you decide that you have a technology which needs to be patented, how do you decide? And B, we would also like to understand, whether, you have these patents for, which mean they are global patents or they are limited to, US or Europe. How do patents work for you? We really want to understand that.
Yes, so those are very good questions. And always, every patent is a little bit specific. Usually, there has to be some uniqueness to the idea of a patent, and it cannot be in the public domain before it is patented. So it is quite a challenge because it means we must develop our products in secret. So they do not enter public domain before we actually have a chance to patent them. But often we need to develop a product, we need to test it, we need to get feedback to ensure that, sometimes it's like the multi-brush, which is probably we'll talk about later with a detachable brushette. That product, we started working in the 90s on that project. And before we actually managed to get something that was working, it almost took us, 20 plus years. It takes a long time sometimes for an invention to be able to materialize. It has to be unique, has to be also kept secret until it's brought to market and patented. The other thing is, how we decide is a very good question. So we usually have a strategy that, of course, our largest markets are the United States and Europe, even though we're present in 100 countries and we're leading in many countries. We still try to focus where it's most cost effective to protect on the distribution side. And then we also protect in manufacturing countries, because the strategy is there's actually very few countries where brushes are manufactured or appliances, and therefore we can achieve maximum effect by patenting in specific countries like Korea, China, maybe sometime Japan or Indonesia, depending on the type of product.
Sure. And here I would like to ask you, are you manufacturing in China?
So we manufacture our hairbrushes mostly in South Korea. We do have also a factory in China. For example, the bamboo brushes, the bamboo grows in China, and therefore the brush must be manufactured in China, because there's one thing about bamboo is that it spoils within 5 days of being stored after the harvest. And so it is a product that must be processed very quickly in order for it to stay intact. So it cannot be, exported somewhere else to be processed. We've also developed technologies of manufacturing, which are have a lot of automation, which also allows us to produce in China as well with high degree of quality and reliability.
Sure. So also we would like to talk about, you know, IP protection in an era of cheaper versions, you know, like, especially in India, I'm sure Shubham faces that, you know, we have a cheaper version of everything, you know, like, and how do you educate and, you know, and also that in India, there is a definitely a need for, you know, cost effectiveness of a product, because majority of our salons are, you know, single salons or standalones and working in a, on a very tight budget most of the time. And of course, we have a number of chains growing now, which is a trend of corporate salons. But how do you operate in India? I would like from both of you, how do you focus? What's your strategy?
Yeah, so it's a it's an interesting point. So, you know, especially some countries, I would say like Brazil, India, China, Iran, where, you know, intellectual property is difficult sometimes to maintain. And it's actually a flattery that, you know, we will travel and see companies that try to imitate our product, at least in the appearance. And but, you know, the thing about our products is that we engineer them to be very heat resistant, to be very high performance. And therefore, once you use a product, you see the difference immediately. Our products can, some of them can be more expensive at purchase per unit, but actually when you look at the lifetime use that you get out of a product, it's actually turns out to be quite often much cheaper to own an Olivia Garden product than an alternative. And I remember very well, we were visiting with Subham, it was kindly taking me around, I think it was Mumbai at the time.
Yeah.
And visiting different salons, and we visited the salon and we were showing a brush which I think was being sold around $16, and the salon owner said, well, it's a very good brush and works very well, but frankly I buy my brushes at $6 to $7.
Yeah.
And we said, okay, well, that's reasonable. And he said, but you know, and I said, how long do they last? And he said, well, I throw them out every week and I buy a new one, but they're so cheap, I don't care. And I said, well, our brush will last you 6 months. So if you do the math, the brush, our brush cost you 1/4 of the cost of the brushes that you're currently purchasing. And so it's a mindset, you know, it's a mind shift that really you have to amortize the life of a product, the cost of a product over the life of a product. And so that's a really important educational point, which sometimes escapes, you know, the average consumer, average salon user. Now, they do know it is a performance, and quite often just that in itself helps promote the product and sell, help a product sell. But actually, if they do the math, quite often they will save money by using quality product.
Sure. Shubham, would you like to add to that?
Yes. As Pierre rightly said, so the good part about Pierre is he's very, very hands-on and he's very passionate about this business. I still remember the time when he was here in India, as he mentioned, we were traveling around different cities, trying to understand various trends. So we really came across, as you rightly said, in India, it is very easy to copy various products, various brands and everything. But the good part that what we realized over this, you might be able to copy the look and finish of the brush, but you cannot copy the quality of the brush. And at the same time, so all Olivia Garden products, they have a science behind it, which I learned after meeting Pierre. So I was so intrigued by his knowledge about the products and the science behind they use in manufacturing these products. So there's a technology in every brush that they have, which is very, very difficult to copy. And that makes, I think that is a strong value addition that stands out to Olivia Garden from the various other brushes which are available in the market.
Sure. And Shubham, you have, you know, amongst your current initiatives is the green revolution in salons.
Yes.
And
yes.
You have been, you know, promoting retail of eco-friendly and ethically sustainable products, you know.
Yes.
And one of them, of course, being Olivia Garden's Eco Hair series. I want to hear more about that series from both of you. You can start.
Okay, so I'll share my Indian journey and then Pierre can share about his global journey with the series of brushes.
Sure.
So in India, so we launched this series last year, and And so we've always seen a growing trend of green and natural organic products which are there in India. So every when we talk about brushes, nobody could ever imagine a situation like this where we talk about the tools. And in India, what we've seen, most of the salons are using the brushes professionally in a salon. The stylists are using. Retailing is not, I would say some of the salons are doing a phenomenal job in retailing of brushes, but not many. If I see a common regular salon, they're not promoting retail of brushes. That's where this concept came into the picture. When we have natural organic products in various hair care, skin care brands, why not in the tools category? So a consumer who wants an eco-friendly product would be willing to invest in certain quality tools, knowing the story of natural organic. And Olivia Garden came up with this series, Eco Hair. I'm having a brush with me in my hand. It's a great, great tool. You see, you have the nice wooden feel of the brush and you have the prints. So the quality of the brush is very, very nice. And for the stylist also to use them, a salon who's looking for green initiatives in terms of the products and everything, they can use these kind of brushes to be used professionally in a salon, as well as it can be given as a retail to their customers, as these brushes are very, very different. And you don't get these brushes competitively in various different retail format stores, which you have. So the success story has been phenomenal. We did a fantastic case study with the JCB salons in Mumbai and they launched this category. We did an event with Olivia Garden's international educators. We had a nice counseling session with the influencers and bloggers over there. And it was a great, great event. I think it was a good start to the line.
So you plan to carry this forward to other salons once they
absolutely, are? Absolutely, absolutely, absolutely. We would love to take this legacy ahead with the rest of the salons as well.
Thank you. Yes, Pierre.
Yes, and so, you know, one of the other important factors is, you know, a lot of people have assumed that environmentally friendly products means more expensive. Environmentally product means that they're more maybe delicate or have some drawbacks as an exchange. But actually, when we develop environmentally friendly products, we also keep in mind the performance for the salon. And this is why up to recently, our bamboo brushes were mostly for retail use. But this new line, EcoHair, is, as Subham said, intended for professional salon use. And so we developed a certain kind of bamboo, which is very resistant to fluids. And that's very important, especially during these days of COVID-19, because the products must be sanitized either through heat or through being exposed in barbicide and disinfectant. And so when we developed this line, we actually spent about 9 months, nonstop, an assortment in barbicide to ensure that the color's fastness and the integrity of the bamboo material would survive. So meaning that the salon could over and over repeatedly on a daily or now almost hourly basis, sanitize a product, even in between each customer, and the product still maintaining its integrity. And so unlike wood, because if you take wood and you put it in water, in fluids, on a repeated basis, it will start swelling and it will lose its effectiveness. It will start splintering. And so the life of a product is actually not as long as than if we were to use this kind of bamboo that we're currently using. So not only is it more environmentally friendly, but it's a higher performance in the salon. We also develop a special grip. The other problem with bamboo, it's a very hard material. And so it's very slippery. It's non-absorbent and it's very slippery in the hand. And the hairstylist must rotate the brush on a regular basis, constantly in their hand. And so it makes it very hard to work with wooden brushes. So we develop a special stain that goes in the product, which gives it almost a rubbery feel to it. And it penetrates a stain that penetrates inside the material and gives it a very good grip. So you can actually hold the product very comfortably as a professional. So there's a lot of features that we have put into the product, which ensures that it will be a very strong and long-lasting product.
So cost-wise, what's the difference between your traditional products and the bamboo products? Is it like a 10% higher or something?
No, that is the other thing. Actually, the bamboo products, the paddles in particular, are very reasonably priced. They're about the same. We try to maintain the same price across the board. So environmentally friendly does not mean more expensive.
Sure. Okay. So now we come to our favorite topic, where, you know, the reason why we are sitting virtually in, you know, yes, our spaces and talking today. So Pierre, COVID, you know, started in China, but it blew up in US. You know, it's like that's how pandemics go. I mean, that's how it happens. Now that we are all flying, and, you know, so also the pandemics also fly. So I would like to really understand how, as a company, you have, you know, weathered this blow, and also as a person, how have you reflected, and, you know, as a leader, what you think, you know, is going to change going forward.
Yeah. So, you know, I would say our history has really helped us in that regards, for two reasons. First of all, even though this is our first global pandemic in 50 years, I would say there's been small ones like H1N and so on we've gone through, but this is really the truly first global pandemic we've experienced. We have experienced radical change before, and through the trends of the beauty industry, and sometimes our markets have virtually disappeared within a 1 or 2 year period. So we are used to experiencing change, and we actually embrace change. It's a mistake for companies, or sometimes even people, to resist change, because you cannot, once you have a global movement, you cannot stand in the way. And so we've learned to embrace change. And so what we, you know, as soon as we saw the sign of what was developing, it was clear they was going to jump across borders, then we prepared for it. So we readied our teams. You know, now our employees are working virtually, except for those absolutely need to be there for certain operations. And again, as a global company with headquarters in Europe and United States, we have already been used since actually 30 years of telecommuting and telecorresponding, and well ahead of the times where even emails, people didn't know what emails were, and we were using forums to exchange information between company staff and so on. So we've been quite experienced with remote working for a long time. The other thing that we also looked at is we realized that for a certain number of time, our clients were going to be shut down, most likely, across the globe and United States. But at some point, life would come back on. So we immediately focused on what would be necessary for our customers to be able to reopen their businesses. And so within a matter of 2 to 3 weeks, we developed actually 20 new products, which we manufactured and flew in by air, mostly in this case because of a short amount of time, to the United States, to Europe, but also to some other international countries as well, of different PPE products, which the salons would need in order to reopen. And when salons were actually allowed to reopen, our wholesale distributors were actually equipped with a product that they needed, disposable capes, you know, face masks, face shields, gloves. These are all products which we never sold before. We were not known to be a glove company, and suddenly we're selling container after container, a lot of gloves. And so our ability to be connected to the market and understand the need of our customers, when people are trying to figure out, well, what do we do to shut down? We were actually figuring out, what do we do to reopen? And so that was really, you know, something that really helped us as a business be able to support our employees and our clients, because besides the welfare of our clients, we're also worried about the welfare of our employees. And of course, that's the welfare of our employees depend on the revenue we're able to generate. So that is always something that we keep in our mind. So actually, you know, we've been quite successful in the last 2 months, equipping, you know, the United States being a large market, Canada as well as in Europe, our clients also distributed all the products we need. We also came up with new products which have not been thought of before. For example, chair covers. You know, we're thinking, how will people protect the customer when they're sitting in a chair. So we develop special chair covers and other items. Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry for butting in. Yesterday, Cherry gave us a very good,
Oh yes, very good.
It was like the chair cover, and then the boys, all the hairdressers we had on the panel were like blown off by the chair cover.
Yes, you know, and we realized, I mean, we first said, you know, it would be necessary, but actually later we realized even more than necessary, because we find out that a lot of customers have allergic reactions to the disinfectants that are being used, and then also the furniture, which is quite expensive, is getting damaged as well from the use of products. So, you know, we work with, you know, Sherry and other also hairstylists to try to also see, understand what their needs are. And that's been the strength of our company, is that, you know, my mother was a hairstylist. I was born in the industry. And so, and we always have the ear. We have actually owned direct sales for some countries, calling directly on salons. We work with wholesaler, international distributors. So it gives us a very good overall view. And I like personally to visit hair salons in India or in Australia or wherever I'm in the world to understand what the needs are of a salon, of a stylist, to answer those needs. Because at the end of the day, we're a company about providing solutions. We don't try to sell a product. We try to help our customer with solutions. And so it's really important to understand what the customer needs.
So yeah, Pia, those are very fantastic points made. And I think this whole partnership, you're just in the right hands, because I've known SK for so many years, and they are the guys who are very diligent. They are the guys who've got great reputation in the market. And they don't rush into things. They, you know, they are like, you know, they do things very properly. They're known for that. And Shubham, I just would like to understand that, you know, post COVID, you know, everything just came to a standstill in India. We know that, you know, the major cities were in Delhi, Mumbai, Chennai.
Absolutely.
We know that nothing moved. And so what was your strategy while, you know, this was happening?
Ritoo, as we actually said, that this pandemic situation has impacted all the businesses in the world, and all of us are already fighting. The first challenge is, of course, to keeping our employees and our customers safe is the topmost priority. Then managing the cash, liquidity in the businesses, apart from all these things which you are already managing in the regular business. The other aspect on the positive side that I see of the situation is that all of us got time to reflect and introspect our businesses, each and every processes. Now, and we were very fortunate to know a lot of people from the industry. So we actually took out time and had a lot of virtual discussions with a lot of our customers and industry veterans, and were taking their perspectives to the situation. Based on that, so what we did, we actually revamped our product portfolio. So of course, we have a plethora of brands and products that we have. So actually, we were very, very specific to certain products which we were focusing at this point of time. Our idea is, right now, the need of the hour is how our products or brands can help salons in order to grow the business at this point of time. We saw an era where everybody was focusing on the various disposable hygiene products and which was very, very important. And I think our industry did a phenomenal job in introducing all the hygiene standards and everything. But we realized that is one part of the story. Now, once that is done, what we can do, what products, what services can actually help them in growing the businesses. That's where we identified the gaps. So we across from the portfolio, we identified like waxing, if I talk about as a waxing as a service, then we saw an emerging trend of roll-on cartridge, which is more hygienic and safe in the portfolio. The beads wax, which are again on the hygienic side. So we identified certain products. Then on the pedicure manicure side, we came up with this waterless pedicure manicure as an idea, which will be very, very safe to be used in a salon, because as per the new social distancing norms, you have to sanitize the pedi station or manicure station after every usage. So it is very difficult for, and a lot of consumers are a little skeptical for going for various pedicure and manicure services. When all the salons are focusing on the basic services, pedicure manicure plays a very important role. That's where this waterless came into the picture, which offers express solutions. Then we actually thought an opportunity of how we can actually boost the retail part. Salons, as you all know, at a news flash, you get to know there's a lockdown in the city. So the salons are shut. The business, it's a tough time for all the businesses. So what we realized that salons, as a fraternity, we need to focus a lot on the retail products, how we can boost in salon retail products. And I think there were case studies during this lockdown. Some of the salons did a phenomenal job of retailing while the salons were shut, but they were retailing products. I think 2020 is a year of survival. So we have to do business and generate revenue in whichever way, in the most ethical way. So I think retail plays a very, very important role. So we identified certain retail products on our portfolio, which could be added across the category, not only just hair care and skin care, where these tools came into the picture. Talking about Olivia Garden, as Pierre mentioned, so they have these various, very, very innovative brands. Last year, they launched a new generation of detangling brushes. So they claim that's the brush that you can sanitize, dip it in water, sanitize it and use it again. So it's a brush, you can easily remove the handles. And these are kind of innovative products we thought might be very, very useful for our clients. So we revamped the strategies then. And so one was, revamped the product. The other aspect which we realized was education plays a very, very important role. A lot of our salons, so the therapists, the stylists, so how do we utilize the time? The best way is to give education. So all our education team, we did a lot of virtual training classes and for all the brands and all the products that we had, if there were any specific query. In fact, we also discussed about education topics from our clients and if they wanted something specific for their staff. So because of our industry network, so we actually collaborated with certain artists and gave them that tailor-made education for those kind of needs as well. So might as well. So that's the least that we can do at this point of time in order to help each other in terms of the education part. The other aspect, the trend that we saw was when it comes to the product part, retailing. So there were a lot of customers we know started home delivery of products, and a lot of our clients we encouraged to start their own e-commerce stores also. So our idea is to max out the reach of products to different. These are the sources of revenues which can help the salons in fighting this pandemic. So we were just involved at all the stages and we would understood their requirements and try to help them in whichever way we could.
Oh, yes, that's very interesting because we all have understood one thing for sure, that omni-channel is the way to go. And
yes,
definitely e-commerce is here to stay. And the more we intensify our presence there, the more it helps every brand. About education, I want to go a little deeper. We understand with both of you, Pierre, that you have a big equity in education. You know, we know that you kind of have a very systematic way in which Olivia Garden has, you know, platform artists who have kind of, you know, gone out and, you know, done these modules on, maybe it's about promoting your hair products, but it's a lot of education going out there, much needed education, especially in a country like India where, you know, there's a huge gap when it comes to systematic education. I would like to understand from you how you want to take this forward. You know, do you want to, you know, kind of create more of education? How do you want to do this? What are your thoughts on that?
Yes, so we have big plans for education. We do believe it's a way of the future. Again, we're really focused on providing solution to our customers first, selling products second. And so we realized that there was an enormous need, actually in every country in the world, for education, especially when it comes to styling hair. Because you can get a lot of hair cutting education, you can get a lot of hair coloring education. Yeah. But when it comes to how to style the hair, there's very little education out there. And even countries that require licensing actually spend very little time educating their students on the proper technique for styling hair. And when a woman goes to a salon, she may get their hair cut, she may get their hair color, but she will not walk out with her hair not done. She will always have her hair styled and done. And so that is the one, and what will give the shape and the look of a hairstyle is the styling itself. And so it's really a key area where we found was a huge lack in education and nobody really willing to step up to do it, because liquid companies want to sell products and they don't really see an incentive in promoting or teaching people how to do hairstyles because they want to focus on directly the use of their product, which usually ends up being hair color. Or hair treatments. And so we have really focused on that aspects, and it's been extremely successful. So now, of course, we believed in in-person education. And so we have traveled with our team of educators around the world, including many times in India, to conduct seminars, trade show education on platform and so on. Of course, with this pandemic that just unexpectedly came, that has changed our ability to travel. But we are putting together educational sessions online, and we're currently working with our educators to provide this education in a virtual setting. We have actually already done with several countries training seminar, educational seminar with our educators. And depending on the status of a country, then we're able to, you know, bring that, depending if the business are active enough in some countries that they're able to bring their employees in a setting where they can view this education, or salons are able to view this education. So that is definitely something we're focusing on. We actually had planned to do this even before the pandemic, because even though we believe in personal education, we can only travel to so many places at once. And, you know, just look at India, it's such a giant country, wonderful country, so many people, we cannot be everywhere at once. So that is definitely, educational platform online is for sure the way of the future, and we're investing a lot in that respect.
Sure.
Shubham, your take. Yes, I think education, as we all know, is very, very important, as Pierre said. And as a brand, Olivia Garden, they are also focusing a lot on education. One thing which I would like to compliment the brand is that each product, each brush that they have in the series, they have this small tutorial videos, like 1 minute, 2 minutes video, which can really help the stylist in understanding the science behind the tool and the usage of the product. And they've been always very, very encouraging in terms of the education and initiative that we can take in India. We did certain education activities with Olivia Garden in India last year. So, of course, the trade shows participation was very, very evident. We did a lot of shows around Sherry and Mandy, who were here with us last year. Then we also did a lot of these education courses in our academy. So they launched this various trend books in different duration. I think last time when we did was a timeless beauty education, which they had launched within the Olivia Garden series. So I strongly feel there's a gap of education where, of course, if we have synergies between both the brands and both the countries together, I think the horizon of education can really go up to the next level. So if we can have the expertise from the brand, and if we have the local expertise, if we combine something together, I think it can be a great opportunity for the market learning experience for everybody, I think. And today, because of the pandemic situation, everything else, we are so well connected at a click of a button. So if we can plan certain virtual series, virtual event, I think that will be very, very encouraging for the industry. That is my opinion.
Fantastic. Before we go on to what vision you have for the next decade, 2020 to 2030, I just want to also, emphasize on one point, which is about mental health. You know, when this is the time when we are increasingly realizing, we've always talked about in our interviews, we've always talked to, senior leaders and, people like you are so busy, how you maintain your fitness. And, mostly we focus on, wellness as in, what's your regime. But we would also like to understand how, in a situation where you are, you see those, your bottom lines just disappearing and, all this happening all around you, how do you maintain your mental health and physical health, of course, and how, you encourage those people who, look up to you for, direction and depend on you as a person, as a leader.
So my philosophy has always been to focus first on the needs of a customer. And the bottom line has always come in second. And this may seem a little bit strange, but it's always worked out. And there's been many times where we took a jump, where you kind of jump off a cliff and you're not sure where you're going to land. But frankly, if you had the interests of your customer in mind and you truly brought a value-added service or product or solution, the landing was always good. And so I think that if we have the interest of our customer first, then that is the best guide to our survival in these very difficult times. Of course, it does take some business savvy, and you have also to manage finances. As Subham said, we had to bring in an entire warehouse of new products, which had to be financed. You had to find a place for it, because you know our leading time for products is 6 months. So we have 6 month inventory, which we know we're not going to be able to sell. And then suddenly you have to bring in an entire new product category. And I see someone smiling because I'm sure he's face the same. And you know, and these are very challenging situation. And you know, you have also have to save for the rainy days, and have to be wise when times are better, then you have to make sure that you save for the rainy days. And so that has been our philosophy. But frankly, at the end of the day, is if you have the best interest of your customer in mind, it has always paid off. And so that's our philosophy. And in terms of the mental health, you know, that's a business health. For mental health, of course, exercise, human interaction is very important. You know, we are people who, as humans, we need contact, we need spiritual guidance, we need interaction with others. Luckily, in this day of technology, we can do this virtually, but it's actually important. It's a very important role that the hairstylist brings, because the hairstylist is quite often a counselor to their clients, and not just a counselor about the hair, but also a counselor about their personal problems and a counselor about the health. And across the world, I talk to hairstylists, and one common thread that comes along is they know more about some of their clients than even the most intimate persons within their client circles does. And so, you know, clearly their clients confide into the hairstylist. And so it's important for hairstylists to be able, they have a trusted relationship with their clients. And that is also how it helps their business, but it also it helps their own clients, not just for the hair, but the well-being of their person. And so hairstylists are advisors, hair advisors about the hair, advisors about the spiritual well-being of a person. And also they can suggest advice about maybe products or certain things that they might be able to sell to the customer to also help them with some of the hair issues or health issues that they may have. To which we might be able to bring some solutions. So one of the things we teach in our education is talk to your clients, engage with your clients, and try to understand what their needs are. Because sometimes hairstylists are artists, and they listen to their clients, but they're afraid to express themselves to their client, or they're afraid to sell something to their clients because they think they're hindering, imposing. Say, I'm an artist, I don't sell anything. I don't, and I think Subham has thought also about retail as well, that sometimes hairstylists can hesitate to retail products to their clients, but really they're advisors, and they're advisors on many different levels. And therefore, in these days of difficulties when many stores are closed, some hair salons might be open. It's a great time to sell to their customers the products that the customers need that they may not even be able to get in other stores because those stores are closed or unable to sell to them. And so it does present some opportunities for hairstylists to make some additional income, which they may not be able to do, because what we do experience is that with the pandemic, you're able to see maybe half the customers that you were able to see before, even if there's a demand for hairstyling services because of the safety guidelines, you can only see so many customers in a day. And so therefore, to stay in business, hairstylists have to find other ways to also create an income stream.
Sure. Thank you. Yes, Shubham.
Yes. I think, as Pierre rightly said, see, we really need to work very, very closely with the clients. And at these tough times, business health and mental health has to coexist. Everybody has to understand it's an ecosystem. It's not only just the end customer, it's the chain. Even for the product companies, it's a tough time right now where we have to actually, we can't it's like where you have to reboot your business, where you can't see the forecasts of your sales, but still you have to do everything at the same time. and you have the responsibility towards your clients, you have the responsibility towards your employees and to all the stakeholders. So it's a challenging time. But I think the key at this point is to remain positive. So their history has proven there have been recessions, there have been the downward trends in various businesses, but then there's always an upside which is waiting for us. We don't know when, but then there is always an upside. So we actually, the idea is, I personally feel is that we should be positive about the situation. Whatever is the situation, we can't do anything. You and me can't change the situation. We have to live with it. The best would be to think of ideas, out of the box ways, how we can actually differently find out solutions to survive at this point of time, and how we can, and the most important is to help each other. It is not something, if I win, you lose, that's not the spirit that everybody needs to work in. And I think our industry has done a fantastic job. I reckon everybody is working so closely together, all the product companies, all the salon fraternity, everybody is working so closely together. And I think this was a blessing of this lockdown. I think this is a silver lining that we see during the situation. And when everybody can come together during these hard times, imagine the good times that are about to come and the kind of initiatives that we can take. And the other positivity that I see is that we all of us are a part of a wellness industry, and which is very, very somewhere down the line linked with the health and well-being of a person. So unlike the other industries which are not relevant. So no matter what happens, a person would definitely like to look good and feel good about themselves. So they would definitely go in for services and everything. So I think if we channelize the strategies and reinvent our business strategies in the right way, I think there are some opportunities even today, which we can actually work together and look at the greener grass, which is still there on the ground, I would say on that level. And on the That was on the again on the business on the personal level, I think balance of life, lockdown, working from home, and all these things have actually enabled us to balance, spend quality time with our family and friends, and everybody is available at a click of a button. And imagine the pre-COVID times, we never used to have time to meet and interact with everybody. Now everybody is available virtually. You can see each other, you can interact with each other, and everybody is there to support each other during these times. And apart from that, well-being is the spiritual. So we are also into meditation, so which we follow. And so meditation is, as always, very, very important for a mental health, and some yoga exercises on a daily basis that really helps you motivated and stay positive during these pandemic times.
Thank you. Yes, all valid points. And yes, in India, we've seen such an effervescence. I mean, it's really amazing that for the first time, Pierre, you must know that, you know, the suppliers, the hairdressers, the owners are now on the same platform. Earlier, you know, it's unprecedented for the industry.
Yes.
And everyone just, you know, kind of being open about what they are doing, what are their strategies. And, you know, they're just, it's quite amazing what, you know, COVID, the challenge has done to the industry. I'm truly like kind of amazed by the effervescence. And so going on before we wind up, I want quick words on how you see the next decade unfolding. What are your, you know, what's your vision for your brands, for the 100 countries that you're in, and, you know, how you want to, you know, kind of take it forward?
Yes, so in the next 10 years, I think that information, not so much in terms of technology, but information, communication is going to be very important. So education is part of that movement. So definitely education is going to be extremely important. Education will have to also be very flexible, on demand. The classical way of learning, especially after the experience of COVID-19, is probably going to disappear. And so there will be much more of an on-demand need for education. And that definitely is a way of the future. I think we'll take, you see it already in universities, a lot of educational institutions, classic educational institutions will not survive this change well after the pandemic. And it was already a change that was starting, but it will accelerate. It presents some opportunities because it allows It basically decentralizes education from one center of learning to brings the education to directly to the individual person. And in that regard, education will be pretty much free, but at the same time, it will greatly benefit the people who receive it, because they will be able to achieve a higher level of learning, which currently probably is not accessible in many places because of distance, because of lack of financial resources. So if this is played out correctly, definitely I think there's a way to uplift not only countries, but populations within a country, and to level the playing field. And you already see the social movement, as you can see in the United States, but also many other countries where there is a movement to try to bring equality. But equality starts with whether it's financial or status in society. It all starts with education, because education is a way we achieve something. And so I really believe that even more than we actually say currently, education is the key. Decentralized education, centralized with each individual, is really the key to improving society as a whole. And that's where we'll be focusing our business. In terms of products, you know, we have focusing a lot of bring innovation in the electrical field, which is a field which we invested once again. We used our products in the 80s, but we had stopped manufacturing in Europe because of cost effectiveness. Now we are manufacturing in Asia, and we bring a lot of innovation in that field. So there will be something we'll be focusing going forward. And we also, the reduction of use of plastics and certain materials is the other field that we're focusing on. We're looking, studying, you know, biotechnologies to produce products which are currently made from plastic and other materials, which would be fully biodegradable, come from plant sources, you know, and would be injected as plastic is. So it's actually quite technical. So we're actually experimenting with different materials and working on different things. But these things are kind of transcendental, and it will take a while before we can bring to market. But for sure, in 5 years, they will be present on the market from our product assortment.
That's fantastic. Before I move to Shubham, Pierre, one more concern that's, you know, hitting all of us in businesses is, of course, the China factor, that, you know, lots of people are viewing it as, you know, manufacturing might be hit, or, you know, there's a lot of angst amongst people about, you know, brands which are manufactured in China, and even an Apple, you know, stopped its production for a while. How do you see that panning out? And, you know,
my experience is the world goes in cycle, just like beauty goes in cycle. It's straight for something long, and then it goes curly again. I mean, every 10 years is a cycle. And so political movements have a similar cycle, you know, so in the 60s, you said in the 70s and in the 80s, and now we see it again, as every action creates over time a societal reaction. And so now we went from one swing, you know, I would say to the right, to one swing more to the left. And that's how the world is a constant balance between different movements. So I think that, you know, China is a society which is evolving, you know, it's got its challenges. I think China in itself is a model which will change over time. It probably will not stay as it is now, but it is a, you know, as India is, it's a very large country, and maintaining a society in a very large and diverse country is a challenge. And so governments have a challenge with that. I do believe that trade barriers and so on are a trend currently. I don't think they will be in the long term, but, you know, we're well diversified also in manufacturing. So we manufacture actually 70% of our products in South Korea. Only about 30% is made in China. And, you know, we're also exploring the ability, you know, with local, 3D printing. I mean, now, you know, I'm currently, one of my relatives, you know, works as a space engineer, send satellites into space. You know, they 3D print the satellites now, you know, to send into space, you know, it's printed, you know, so why couldn't we print a hairbrush? And so, you know, that's definitely, we're all technologies we're investing in. And we're not there yet, but there will be a day where, you know, we could very well manufacture again in the United States these kind of products. So I do think that as there's a decentralization in information and education, there will also be a decentralization in manufacturing as technologies allow it. Maybe 10 years might be a little bit early, but maybe in 10 years it will be possible to, you know, customize. You already see shoe manufacturers, for example, now moving back their shoe manufacturing to Germany and producing 3D printing shoes, you know, high-end athletic shoes. And so, you know, there's movements like that are taking place, and we're studying all of them very closely to try to stay ahead of all these trends.
Yeah, and we do hope that at some point it'll be in India as well. Shubham, your take on your vision for the next.
As we discussed during our topics today, so if I talk about on the product side, our vision is, of course, green revolution will play a very, very important role in strategizing our products oriented line, which is hair care, color, skin care, everything around it. Then you're also boosting in salon retail, which we've already spoken about. And we're also eyeing value added services and top up services, which can be extension to the existing lines of services, which are already at the salons. We are eyeing certain categories in that domain as well on the product space. Apart from that, we are also exploring opportunities within India for the made in India products, some there, how we can do it. So that's also there in our cards. We are also investing heavily on the digitalization of all the tools that we have. We are working very closely, or we already have an online platform that we are working, how we can enable that platform to assist salons in the business at the moment. So in the coming time, online will play a very important role in strategizing our channel strategies. Then we are also investing heavily in a strong IT-backed infrastructure. So what we are doing right now is we are actually planning in the future to automate the entire sales field, sales process that we have, our sales team members, our educators, and even our channel partners, how we can use technology in order to have a better sync in all the across the partners so that we are able to service our customers more effectively. The other side we are also doing is we are digitalizing the core processes within the team, how platforms where we can actually engage our team members and the external team members so that we can work very, very closely. Lastly, on the education part, we are digitalizing again. So overall, digitizing the online and the offline strategy. So online will play a very, very crucial role in the coming time period and with the new products that we have. So that will be the key for strategies for the next decade within the company.
Fantastic. So thank you gentlemen for joining us on Beauty Espas TV today, and that was a really great conversation, and we wish you well. We wish you stay safe, stay connected, and let us know whenever you have new developments so that you can always have a quick chat online, at least before we can meet physically.
Yes. So thank you so much, Rituji. And I think it was a great session, and you've been always taking innovative initiatives for the industry since so many years. And it's always a pleasure to be a part of your initiatives. Thank you so much for inviting us at this platform.
Yes. Thank you very much. Really a pleasure to see you again. And we hope to be back in India very soon to meet you again in person.
Yes, definitely. Thank you. And have a great day. Thank you.
And thank you.
Good night to you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.